with that. Thank you very much. The largest living things. Give him another one. With the old buddy Paul Hester out the front. How are you, bro?
I'm happy as Larry. I'm in the seat. I'm rocking. I'm here with my mates. There's food on the table and there's money in the hip pocket.
All right. It's a recipe for disaster. Are you going to introduce your buddies for us?
Well, I've got a boy from Pai Kokoroki, New Zealand, Barry Stockley on the bass guitar.
Love you, Barry.
And I got a lovely bubbly tub of fun here on the guitar, all the way from New York City, escaping parking permits, Mr. Kevin Garand.
Beautiful. And we'll be dropping in with the boys from time to time. All right, welcome to the show. It's looking a little lonely up here right now, but don't panic, because very shortly these couches are going to be populated by, well, some of this country's top shelf comedy talent. And can we swing a camera around? Because I wouldn't mind just getting a shot and introducing you now. Where do we start? Look out, is that Tony Martin on the end over there? What's going on?
Hey, Tony. All I can say, Mick, is I hope this show's going to be as good as The Pretender. It's top here tonight.
Big shoes to fill, Tone. We'll be checking up with you a little later. Right next to him is Bobby Franklin. So,
and thanks, Mickey. It's a welcome change of pace.
Can you do me one favour? Just settle it down a tiny bit. A little over the top right now. Take your medicine. Who's that next to you? Would that be Lee Patch? Patchy! Patchy, of course, is the only member of the team who still gets his hair cut at the barber. Hello, is that Ross Hammond? Is that Ross Hammond? How are you, Ross? Welcome, Ross, aboard. Here's what we can do, Ros. I remember you having a particularly good party trick where you could name each of the Melbourne Cup winners as I call them. Can you do that?
I can try.
1861.
Archer.
Okay. 1910.
Comedy King.
Thank you, but who won?
That's cold.
1922.
King and Goda.
King and Goda. 1975.
Think big.
Okay. Now, do you want to leave or come back tomorrow night and play for the cards? It's
I'll
up
leave.
To you. All right. Who's that next to you? That looks to me like Judith Lucy. Looking forward to you plonking the buns in the couch up here, Jude.
No, not as much as me. I'm fit as a fiddle and ready for love.
Well, I hope you are, because they're pretty comfy couches, and I reckon I could get to second or third base tonight. And they're scotch guarded too. Oh, it's Pendo! Look at Pendo! Yeah.
Come on!
Pendo's going to come in a little later and talk sport, some more sport, and then, if we have time, even more sport, because that's what he loves. All right, that's the crew. This is the set. We haven't exactly gone out on a limb. Here's our balmy idea. We thought, wouldn't it be great to kind of create an inner city warehouse vibe down the wrong end of town? And this is what we came up with. That, of course, is our neighbourhood. And why don't we go and check? See what's happening out there. Hello, there's a pair of binoculars. Might just use those. Let's just see if we can't locate a few of our neighbours. Okie dokie. Okay. Oh dear. That's a little tragic, isn't it? He's ironing his pants. That's a big job for a clown. That could go on forever. Okay, that could have been a radio clown, I reckon. He's not quite on top of that. Where are we now? Alrighty, what have we got here? Oh, look out. Here's trouble. And I just can't see. Oh dear. That's going to end in tears. And just quickly before we go, let's just see what the. Oh dear. Might just leave that there. Could be trouble. All right, have I got all the mechanical details out of the way? We know where we are. We know who everyone is. We know the band. Look, ordinarily on a first show, things can get a little hectic and you kind of, well, you stress out just a tad, but there's just been no evidence of that on this show. Basically, I think because we did a really kick-ass pilot. Was the what? Yeah.
You liked the pilot.
Well, I think everyone did. Arch, did you like the pilot?
I loved it, mate.
Arch liked the pilot? What's your problem with the pilot?
Oh, no, I thought we had a bit of room to move with the pilot. I don't know, wasn't that... You were happy with...
Hang on. You don't think I nailed the pilot?
Oh, no, I mean...
Oh, no. Okay, we'll put this to bed now. Do we have a clip from the pilot?
Sure.
We could show?
Yeah.
Let's go to that.
Swinging fun. Here we go.
Please thank them all, the largest living shits. Hello, Paul. Stay up all night working on that, did you? Neil Finn made you.
G'day, Mick.
Hey, music boy, give me another drink. I chunned it in that. What? Oh, so it's over to me, is it? Over to Funny Man to turn on the funny tap. I'm on the telly. I need a drink. There's no beer in the fridge. This girl has 12 breasts.
It's not that bad.
I'm sorry, Archie.
One more take.
I tried. Yeah, you know everything, Mr. TV man. Hi. Essie, I'm writing my name. What? Larry? MJ!
This one's well and truly over.
No? Who's looking stupid now? No need to panic. Everything's under control. All right, that's everything out of the way. Oh, hey, one last thing. It has been a big day for me because this doesn't happen all the time. But today, my picture actually went up in the Channel 9 foyer, and that's quite a big thing in TV. I'm not sure if you're not familiar with it, that means you've made it. And if we've got a minute, Archer, can I... Yeah, come on, we'll have a look at my picture. It's in the foyer.
Come on!
Let's do it. Oh, here we go. How bad can it be? You can see all the other pictures up on the wall. Oh, look, here's a good one, Glenn Ridge. It looks like he's on the crapper. He's reading. I'm suggesting it's number twos. Come on. All the good ones are on the walls. Here we come. This must be champagne television. Oh, hello. Can't go past this without saying something smart.
Call me. Call me now.
Hello. It's all happening here. And here it is, the prestigious Channel 9 foyer. Hello, girls. How are we going? That'll be a complaint you're answering over there, wouldn't it? It'll be the previous scene. My name's Mick, I'm new here. How are you? What's your name?
Joe.
Would you like a date after the show? Really? Really?
No, I've got to go home to my family.
Family, schmamily, we don't need them. Hey, here we go. See, the big pictures, they're all around. Here we go. You got the chairman of the board there, Eddie McGuire, right up next to Daryl, the man. He's already been on tonight. Raimondo, and hello. Check it out. There it is. Look at the girls. They cannot concentrate on their work. Absolute stud muffin standing there in his lolly bags. You're covering in the nether regions, aren't you? All right, let's go back. Come on. Got a TV show to run here.
Come on,
can't just muck around.
Come on,
so I got a stitch. Here we go. Come on. There we go. It's nearly over now. I think we've done it all. Yeah. Oh, that went well. Yeah. Dudes, are we ready to go?
Yeah.
Australia, hold on, it's spider bait! We're doing all right.
We're doing well.
No one's panicking yet, are they?
I got calls all over Australia, then flooding in saying, keep going.
Thanks, mate. That's the way we like it. Oh, hello. It's Judith Lucy.
What hey, the
Oh, jeez. How's it going, Jude?
Look, Mick, I'll be candid with you. I'm already sweating like a pig. I'm going to have to laminate my own armpits. But apart from that...
We'll have someone here, surely, who can do that.
Oh, yeah, well, it's Channel 9.
Someone
Come
from
on.
Props. Laminate Jude's armpits now.
Immediately. But hey. My buns wouldn't want to be parked anywhere else. I'm
Good
telling
on you
that Jude. Now.
Thank you very much. Now, Jude, when was the last time we worked on telly together? Was it the Late Show?
I believe it
I
was.
I think it might have been.
Celebrity Squares.
Celebrity Squares. And you got the middle square.
I know.
Which is the important one. Everything goes through the middle square on Celebrity Squares. We did a great sketch on the Late Show, which I remember fondly.
Oh,
I can't believe
dear.
It's not on any of the videos. The Blue Lagoon sketch.
That stayed with me.
Yes. I was in a loincloth, you were in a coconut bra, and apparently it's big on the European porn circuit. So,
and we were both doing a bit of fancy wig work,
Hello.
I recall as well. You had a bit of a blonde perm.
I did, and a merkin to match. It's after 9:30, isn't it? You can say that now. You can say that. Now, Jude, before we get into some gear, I just feel obliged to make one explanation because I've been banging on endlessly now about the couches.
If
you've seen our promos, it's all about the couches. And when we came up with the idea for the show, we really decided that it was paramount to get two comfy couches and a coffee table and try and replicate the vibe you have in your own lounge room. So we actually, it was quite a big task to go out and find the couches for the show. Now, I had some company on a very exciting day out, and a couple of good friends of mine who are over there, they're writers on this show. I'm talking about Simon Morley, Darren Chow, and Justin. And we went out looking for couches on a very special day for this show, and I'm going to show you highlights from that day. And before I do, I should just point out, we really love our couches.
Cause all we need is candlelight, you and me, and a bottle of wine, and I'll hold you tonight. Well, we know I'm going away, and how I wish it were so. So take this wine and drink with me, let's delay our misery. Say tonight, fight the break of dawn, come tomorrow. Tomorrow I'll be gone, say tonight.
This has taken me 3 hours. You must have wanted it really badly.
Well, not really. My mates just wanted to sit on your couch.
Say tonight, fight the break of dawn, come tomorrow. Tomorrow I'll be gone, say tonight.
Couch. 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 That's a couch.
Look, what seems to be the problem here?
Oh, no, there's no problem. I'm fine. I'm just here for the couch.
To say goodbye, darling, please don't stop to cry. So girl, you know I got to go.
Sydney's lunch discounters.
At Sydney, our philosophy here is to stack them high, sell them low, with lots and lots of stock to go. And this week we're celebrating the opening of our brand new superstore at Ferntree Gully. And what the heck's going on here? What's up here?
Sydney's lunch discounters. Sydney's got the lunch for you.
You know, this place is kind of good, but I know a really wild and crazy joint, if you know what I'm saying.
So, fellas, what's it going to be? Is this the one?
Ooh, I don't know. Something's missing. Oh, I know.
All right, well, what about that? Is that better, fellas?
Yeah, it's better, but something's still not quite right.
Getting comfier all the time. Just about perfect. Although...
Right, so you're going to take the couch or what?
There's some thinking music. No, I don't think so.
You know, I like a lot of these couches, but how do you know they're safe?
How did you find out?
Righto, guys, keep the engine running. I'm on in five. This won't take a second.
No
all right?
Worries.
No worries.
All
right. Break away.
When my baby, when my baby smiles at me, I go to Rio de Janeiro, Mayo Mio. I go wild and I have to do the samba, Alabamba. Now I'm not the kind of person with a passion of persuasion or dancing or romancing. But I give it to the rhythm and my feet follow the beat of my heart. Whoa, whoa, when my baby stops at me, I go to Rio. When my baby stops at me, the satellite end of my life, and I am free at last.
Come out of your shell. That's what I want to know.
That's the question on everyone's lips. Hey, can I just thank a couple of people from that? Of course, the people from The Boy from Oz. And Todd Kenny himself is a damn good bloke, and I can we have him on the comfy couch right here soon.
Please.
And Leslie Shaw, who organised that. Thank you very much. And for some reason, we're plugging Autolive, where they crash stuff. I'm thinking of heading down there with 40,000 human nature CDs. And just whamming them in all! Come on! That's gotta be good. They'll crash anything. They actually love crashing the couches because they're actually allowed to laugh. They're going, well, we're normally not allowed to laugh at the crashes, but since it's only a couch, we're gonna go the cack. So anyway, that's out of the way. And there is the couch, by the way. That was the one we found. Good stuff. We're not gonna get a shot. There we go, right over there. Yeah. People love it. Beautiful. It's gold, it's big, it's beautiful. Enough about couches. What can we do for you, Judith Lucy?
Well, Mick, I'll tell you what.
Mm.
I thought to myself, look, it's the first show. How about, you know, you and I just ease in with a topic that we're both fairly relaxed with.
Yep.
So it was a bit of a toss-up between dressmaking and piss. And I've decided to go with the latter.
Okay.
Now, I don't know if you've come across any of these ads that have been popping up in magazines lately for Frangelico.
Mm.
Are we getting a shot of that? The line is, I'll always remember my first Frangelico. Now, right off the bat there, surely if the drink was any good, it should be, shit, I wish I could remember my first Frangelico.
Absolutely.
And now, what they've done is they've gotten a series of real people. Here we have the actor, Andre Eckmeyer. And can we have another look at that? Because I want to make sure people recognise Andre. And I'll be honest and say that I couldn't give a rat's ass when Andre had his first Frangelico. But I'd like to hazard a guess because I think lovers of quality television will recognise Andre. And I reckon he had his first Frangelico or 20 before he signed his Pacific Drive contract. Now, it goes on to say a few things about Andre.
Oh, yeah.
He's apparently formed a production company with four passionate friends.
Oh, okay.
I don't actually have friends with feelings. I just hang out with people who act a bit like Jaime from Get Smart. And I love the fact that they're, well, I thought to myself, four passionate friends, and I bet they're probably actors too. Mm. So I reckon the word he wasn't looking for was passionate so much as unemployed.
Right.
But now, I was also wondering if Andre was his real name, and it probably is, but I did actually, this is true.
Mm.
I know of an actor in Melbourne who actually changed his name from Andrew to Andrea. Anus.
Okay.
Another option there clearly would have been Wanker. I'd actually like to be referred to as Juanita Lucy from here on in.
Hello.
Another line here is, my family and I have started a tradition of having Frangelico after regular dinners together. Now, the Lucy family, we were into that years ago.
We're going to open this can of worms now.
We are. We'd sit down to a hearty meal of, you know, some pre-packaged shredded ham, and we'd play our favourite game, which was name the family you'd prefer to belong to. And then it was just Frangelico's all round. Now, look, you know, then he goes on and he suggests that you pop... This will upset you.
Okay,
I'm glad you're sitting down.
Thanks for preparing me.
You pop your Frangelico into your coffee. Mm. What is this obsession with people ruining liquor by adding other things to it?
Have you
seen anyone add cranberry juice to their methylated spirits? I think not. Now, and this is my major problem all with right. Andre, mm-hmm. because he doesn't look like a drinker. Okay. I mean, a drinker wouldn't be able to afford this kind of lovely leather chair that he's got happening.
That's true.
I'll tell you what I've got in my living room. Mm. I've got a lovely modular lounge suite that I've fashioned entirely out of stubbies. And I'll tell you now that when the light hits that stubby couch, it's a thing of rare beauty.
I'm sure.
Now, we move on to Louise Olson.
Oh, hello.
And she designs stuff for dinosaur designs. I mean, she's at least holding a glass, but I'll tell you something, Mick. The older I get, I think, why bother with the glass?
Mm.
When you can just scull straight from the bottle.
And sure.
This is a true story. A friend of mine recently stayed.
Yeah.
Got a million of them.
Oh, nice.
Stayed in a hotel on the outskirts of Brisbane. He was in the restaurant. He just had cutlery at the table. He ordered a bottle of wine. Waitress came up, plonked the bottle of wine down on the table and actually said, would you like a glass with that? Now, you see, that's my idea of service. Would you like a glass with that or maybe just some sort of tap? Now, if I had been approached to advertise some sort of alcoholic beverage, and I'll tell you right now, I'm quite stunned that I haven't been up to this point.
Sure.
In fact, the only thing I've ever been asked to advertise was a type of panty liner. And they won't do you much good in a cocktail shaker, but this is the kind of photo I'd use. Now,
that's the
now Mick, that's actually a shot of me flirting.
At the height of your courting ritual.
Indeed, and this will shock you. That was actually a reconstruction of an actual event that happened a few years back, I hasten to add, out with a group of people. I was trying to impress this guy, so naturally I drank until I literally passed out into a plate of dips. And can I say what hummus can do for a girl's complexion? But it was a great ploy because while I was unconscious, my friend was actually able to turn to this guy and list some of my finer qualities.
Okay.
Obviously, top of the list was she can really hold a liquor. And I would just generally recommend it because I think, as both you and I know, Mick, women are nothing more than mysterious pretty traps. And I'd actually recommend passing out on your date to girls because then you not only come across as being fairly enigmatic, but you look like you're playing hard to get.
That's sound advice.
This will stagger you, though. I actually didn't wind up going home with that boy that night.
Oh, hang on a second.
I know.
It's off the rails. What happened? Where did your canny plan fall down, Jude?
I'm telling you, no idea, because I think we know from the photo that not only would we have been in for a fun night of romance, but, I mean, he could have saved himself the cost of a meal by just licking my face. No one would have been losing there.
It's the Judith Lucy meal deal.
Exactly.
It's all in one package. Well, that's a fascinating insight into your private life, Jude.
Oh, you'll be getting a lot more of that.
Hey, we're talking alcohol. Here's a story. This is in the papers today.
Mm-hmm.
We've got the story here. Have you seen this? They're actually putting drinks warnings now on bottles of alcohol.
Oh, for God's sake.
No, this is actually true. I wouldn't make it up. They're putting drinks label, like they have on cigarette packets, onto the old liquor bottles. And I've got a couple of them here. Surprisingly. Here's one you might remember, Jude. This is fantastic. Oh, yes, this is a classic one, and it's appropriately on a West Coast cooler. And it reads, contents may cause some teenagers to lose their virginity. That's apt. Here's a good one. Oh, I like this. Yep, and appropriately labelled too. Warning, contents may cause you to join in on the chorus of Don McLean's.
Hey, Mick, do any of those warnings say may cause you to urinate on the set of your own program?
Are you referring to me or you? Hey. I'm prepared to go in sympathy. Come on! here's a good one. On that note, while we're at it, here's a good one, and this is one I think that should be heeded. Warning, contents may cause NRL players to hurl their own poop around room.
Lovely.
Tasteful reminder. And here's a good one, on a bottle of vodka. Warning, contents may cause you to make an ass of yourself. And if you don't believe me, check this guy out. Now, he's had a couple. Right there, he's hosting the G7 meeting. I'm telling you.
But he's having fun.
That's my main thing.
Exactly.
We're all having fun. All right, that's enough, Boris. Judy, you got to come back later in the show.
Oh,
and
try
hang
and
about.
Stop me. You
thanks
betcha.
For coming out. Thanks for coming out early and helping me out. I really do appreciate
my
it. Please
pleasure.
Make a well, welcome to be here, Judith Lucy. We'll be back in a second with Bobby Franklin. Big Kev! Big Kev's going nuts on the guitar! Good stuff, Kev. Barry, Hesse. Oh, good to have you on board. Bugger me, it's Bobby Franklin. Oh, hello! Before we get cracking, Bob, I feel obliged to ask, how's your week been?
Well, it started very strangely, actually. Me, no. I was approached by the Adult Literacy Board, who offered me a substantial amount of money to use this show to promote their ends.
All right.
Their ends, of course, being the promotion and development of literary skills amongst those adults who haven't fully grasped them.
Mm-hmm. And what did you say?
Well, I said no, obviously. Yeah. I felt that it would compromise.
Sure.
I felt it would compromise this show to accept. So although it was a substantial amount of money, I did turn them down.
Mm-hmm. And what form did your refusal take?
Mick, I wrote them a letter. Mm-hmm. I placed my address in the top right-hand corner.
Okay.
Like so. I also put the date under the address, just as a point of reference.
Sure. Yeah, absolutely. Well done, Bob. To be honest, I was also offered money by the Adult Literacy Board, but I turned them down as well, so I think we both deserve a pat on the back, because it's easy to become corrupt when large sums of money are on offer.
It certainly is, Mickey. Now, I've noticed you've used the word corrupt there. What do you mean by that?
Corrupt, Bob. Dishonest, without integrity, influenced by bribery.
That's right, Bob. It comes from the French corrupt, or the Latin corruptus.
That's impressive, Roz. How come you know so much?
I think you'll find she's been reading one of these, Bob. You'll find information about the word corrupt in any dictionary or thesaurus.
Thesaurus, Jude? That sounds like some kind of prehistoric animal. But seriously, they are very useful here. I'll certainly know where to look next time.
Mm. But isn't it time now, Bob, to delve into a book of a different kind?
Yes, it is, Mickey. It's time to delve into Bob's scrapbook, a collection of moments, images, episodes from life in the big city. It could be yours.
John Cassidy? Hello, John. Come through. Find us all right?
Yep, no problem.
Take us off. Now, John, you're aware that if your application is successful, you will be required in part to act as liaison to our Vietnamese workers.
Yep.
All right. Now, what I have here is a list of phrases and questions and so forth, which I'd like you to translate.
Sure.
All right. Here we go. Number one, The canteen is on the third floor.
The canteen est on the third floor.
What are you doing?
Sorry, I thought you wanted me to translate it into Vietnamese.
Yes, I do, but that's not Vietnamese, that's English.
Now, this is English. Now, I'm speaking in Vietnamese.
Yes, you see, that's not Vietnamese, that's just speaking English with a Vietnamese accent.
Is it?
Yes.
Well, what's Vietnamese then?
Vietnamese is a totally different language.
Right. Can I still have the job?
No.
Well, good luck finding someone who speaks two completely different languages.
The third incident took place here, 5 km from the first. Same MO, similar witness descriptions. It looks like it was the same team.
Sorry to interrupt, Ken. Fellas, this is D.I. Jane Radisson from K Division. She's going to give us a hand on this one.
G'day.
Jane, man.
Right, man.
Morning.
Carry on, Ken. We just sit with her back here.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes, Gary.
Is she going to be, like, making coffee and stuff?
No, she's going to be helping us solve this crime. Is there a problem?
Well, in case anyone hasn't noticed, she is a girl.
What's your point, Gary?
Well, my point is I wouldn't have joined this gang if I'd known you were going to let girls in.
It's not a gang, Gary. This is the police force.
See, that's typical. You want to argue over a name, but you're quite happy to let girls in.
What exactly is the nature of your complaint, officer?
Now she's trying to talk like us. The nature of my complaint is that if my brother finds out I'm in a gang with girls in it, my life won't be worth living.
Can I have a word, John?
Sure.
Look, you may have to step down on this one.
What?
I know it's frustrating, but you don't know Gary's brother. If he's going to tease him over this, then it's just not worth it.
Oh, look, I've got an older sister too, so I know what it can be like.
I'm sorry, Jane.
No hard feelings.
I'd rather not touch you with the boys watching.
Should I just leave?
Could you?
G'day, mate.
How are you?
Good, how you going?
Good.
Where are you off to, buddy?
Just in the city, thanks, mate.
Beautiful. In town for long?
A couple of days.
What's that for, business, is it?
Yeah, mainly business.
You ever had sex with a man?
Just drop us here, thanks, mate.
No problem, mate, sure.
A treasure trove of memories you've got there. Hang on to that, you'll have that forever.
Well, I think if something matters to you, Mick, it still matters at 30,000 feet.
That's right, indeed. All right, hey, Arch, what are we doing? I know what we're doing. We're going to have a number from the boys, are we not?
Oh, I think it's
Do you
time.
Mind? Would it be forward for me to ask you to punch one out right here, right now?
All right, amps on, eyes front, largest living things. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Girl, and rub until it happens.
There you go. Thank you, boys. Thank you, boys. Hey, what was that song you played before the break, Hesse? What was it called?
That's called Thumbs.
That's called Thumbs. That's a cracker, mate.
It's coming up on an album. I think it's Bon Jovi's album. And yeah, yeah. Yes. Coming up.
As long as you're happy, I'm happy too.
I'm happy tonight, Mick.
Is that an original Van Gogh behind you, Hesse?
Yeah, it's original as opposed to a classic.
Okay. I think that's... And you'll be taking tours through your gallery after the show?
I've got something here. I've got a hole in the wall here.
No,
I've got all sorts of things. There's something down here on the floor I think we'll be dealing with later on after the show. But definitely, everything's happening.
We'll leave it there. We'll leave it there. And in the meantime, here's Trouble. It's Tony Martin. Oh, yeah.
Oh, it's good to be here, Mickey.
It's good to have you here too, I might say.
Well, I've just realised, is this the first new Australian television program of the can-do era? Is it?
I think it may be.
Because has John Howard declared this the...
This is, the can-do country.
How does that work?
I don't know.
Is it like, what's that, Mal? You'd like all charges dropped in return for passing my GST through the Senate. Can do. is that what he's on about there?
I think you might be onto it. Here's what made me laugh. There was something on all the news services tonight, and they're saying John Howard's heading to America for a showdown. And all I'm getting is a mental image of John Howard in chaps. One of those cowboy hats with a string under the neck.
Going, all right, lead me to Boot Hill. I'm just picturing his wife packing stuff. It's my good car to get in there because this is a serious meeting.
I mean business.
That's right.
There you go. Yeah. There you go. Now, Tone, look, it is a first show. Yep. It's a special occasion. Hmm. And we're pretty good buddies.
Yep.
Have you bought me anything special?
I've bought you some top stuff, Mickey.
Have you?
I've got you a very rare clip.
Get out.
Which is a clip of an incident which happened here on Channel 9 many years ago, which was so shocking that Channel 9 management at the time, this is true, demanded every copy of it be erased.
Wowee.
And I've been told that, I don't know how, I have the only existing copy of what happened. And it's a good lesson for you, Mickey, because this is a live show.
Yep.
And things go wrong.
Oh, yeah.
And you have to know how to handle it when they do go wrong.
Oh, yeah.
Who does that better than anybody?
Okay, you're talking TV masters.
Yep.
Well, you can't go past Bert.
Bert Newton.
He's
Bert
been there.
Newton. And this is an example of Bert handling a bit of a mistake on a live television program better than anyone ever could.
Okay.
Picture yourself in this scenario. Picture yourself as Bert, right? And I should warn people that, viewers of a nervous disposition or sensitive disposition may find this footage offensive.
I think we might have to pull the whip.
Well, time is unimportant, of course.
Whoever finishes first.
I tell you what, you boys, if you don't feel too well, you can perhaps finish this.
And you have been so heavily fired.
The bloke's still going.
He just forges on like nothing has happened.
And he just moves across frame. It never happened. Not listening.
And if you look closely, the spray actually goes across the nice bookshelf at the back.
Can we have another look at the money shot?
Can we have another close look?
I tell you what, you boys, if you don't feel too well, you can cut the first one.
That is fantastic. But Tony, can you explain this? What is the segment? Is that it's a drinking competition on telly?
How did we miss that era of Australian television?
That's
yard glasses at the ready.
Yard glasses, I reckon. We've got to get everyone their own yard glass and hang it up there like a gun cabinet. And whenever you feel the need, chug one down.
Bring it back.
And you have the only copy of that?
That is apparently it's serious. There was so much trouble, every copy was supposed to have been erased.
So that's like the Australian version of the Zabruder footage.
It is. Back and to the right.
Back. That's the way he spewed.
The funny thing is, he actually looks as if he's going to spew off camera, and he thinks, no, let's get this one.
He's gone, this could make the
promo.
They'll be needing this on the Mick Molloy show.
I'm tipping there'll be plenty of that over the next 20 weeks, and it's no accident I looked that way when I said it. Dear, oh dear. So that's it? You're done?
No, I've brought you something else.
Oh, bloody hell. This is my special day.
I've brought you a new character for the show.
Oh, this is going to be fantastic.
Do you have any characters?
No regular characters as yet.
Well,
no.
You do now. Please welcome Mini Mick. Here he comes now.
They get stuck a lot of you.
Hang on a second. The dwarf just swore. What the hell's going on here? It's Mini Mick. How are you, bro?
Good, how you doing?
Yeah, not too bad. Anything all right with you?
All right.
Yeah?
Blow it out of your ass, will you? Come on.
No, blow you blow it out
of
your ass.
No, you blow it out
of
your ass.
No, you blow it out of your ass. No, you blow it out of your ass. 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 All right. All right.
Come on.
All right.
Come on.
Come on. All right. I want Mini Mick to go and stand in the corner, preferably on a couple of telephone books, and have a think about it. When you're ready to rejoin the group, come back.
Blow it out of your ass.
Hey, come here.
I told you to be a good present.
Bro, that's the best. How you going, bro? Doing well with the ladies, I'd bet.
All right.
Hey. What have you got in your pocket there? What is this? Hang on a second.
Here you go.
It's a tiny package.
When he blows loud, look, you look pretty comfy in between me and Roz.
Yeah.
Would you care, Roz, maybe to join me and Mini Mick a little later for a two and a half some?
Delightful.
Well, I'm staggered. I'm absolutely overawed.
Yep.
We're going to go out cruising. We're going to stay on the town for a while, I reckon. We're going to be in. Mini Mick, you're a genius. You bought me footage of a bloke spearing and a bloke who looks like me, just a little smaller.
But it wasn't as easy as it looks.
Oh, really?
You want to know how we found Mini Mick?
I'm all ears.
It was a very rigorous audition process. One of your producers here, John Tabar, and myself.
John Tabar.
We held auditions in your office earlier in the week.
Okay.
And we've got some footage here. Have a look.
John. There's only three, one of them dropped out.
Okay, now look, I'm just worried there's not going to be any chemistry between me and
relax.
The little
You'll
people.
You'll be fine.
Tony, can I leave the dog in here?
No, Pen, don't leave him in here. Really? Mick doesn't like dogs in his office because they find his stash. So cut that bit out. Make sure you cut that bit out. John, I'm just... What do I call them?
No, just fine.
Do you say dwarves?
No, they're dwarves, okay. But just refer to them by their names.
Because I don't want to get...
They're normal people.
I don't want to get it wrong, because you don't want to offend them.
Just act...
This is personal experience talking. The last thing we want is a bunch of angry midgets on our hands.
Okay, let's just do it. It'll be fine.
All right. Thanks for coming along,
What the?
Oh, look. Don't worry. He's fine. He's great. He's, Pony ride, anyone? Okay. Look, thanks for coming in. We're going to be interviewing you individually first up, but while you're waiting, we've got refreshments in the kitchen on a low shelf. So just sing out if there's anything you don't understand or can't reach.
Oh, look, I'm so sorry I'm late.
Pete, what are you doing here?
Well, I'm here for the audition.
Yeah, but we're looking for people who are a bit more, you know...
I look a lot shorter on camera.
I'm sorry, Pete, but you're not even supposed to be in Mick's show anyway.
Look, I'm Mini Mick. Blow it out your bot.
Sorry about that. John, is that room free yet?
Sorry, it'll be just a couple of minutes.
Okay. So, how are we all? Guess you guys must be pretty happy about the cargo pants craze. It makes it easier to pick people's pockets. Okay, we're in. John? Oliver, thanks for coming by. Sorry about that earlier. I'm just,
worries.
A bit nervous about this.
Yeah.
Can I ask, are you familiar with Mick's work?
Oh, absolutely. I followed Mick Everson, his progression in the media ever since I came over here.
And can you do a bit of a Mick for us? Because if you're successful, you'll be required to.
Blow it out your ass.
Pretty close. Arthur, are you much of a fan of Mick Molloy yourself?
I love the guy, yeah.
Let's see your Mick Molloy impression. Can you do one for
me? Why you take a flying f***ing rolling diet, my friend?
You know, those are the exact words he said when he met Peter Reef. Yeah, that's true. Can you do a Reefy?
Peter Reef, no.
Oh, it's pretty much the same thing, but you're talking to an unemployed person. And what about an impersonation? Do you think you can get up a bit of an impression of Mick for us here today?
Hey, Mick Molloy, you're a f***ing idiot.
So that's Mick calling himself a f***ing idiot. Yes. Okay, that's not bad. And what about acting work? Would we have seen you in anything at all?
You might have. You got to look really quick, because I just, you know, they don't...
Oh. Can you hear that? It was your flying line.
That's right. Sorry.
Now, Shane, I notice you're a little bit larger than Arthur and Oliver.
Yes.
You reckon you can take them on?
Oh, I'd kill them, yeah.
Yeah? Yeah,
both together.
We'll tee that up if we could, Si. Now, Arthur, obviously, if you get this role, I mean, there's going to be a lot of groupies, a lot of mini Mick fans. Are you ready for this?
Yeah, sure. Ready, all ready. Got the beard, got everything going, yeah.
Okay, cool. A message for your potential fans out there?
Come and get me, baby!
Guys.
Excuse me.
Thanks for waiting. John and I have talked it through, and hate to say this, but we're not even sure that we've found our mini Mick here today.
Sorry, guys.
But wait, we've prepared something for you.
You guys have?
Yes.
We've prepared something?
Stand back.
Okay.
Hit it!
I didn't realise it was such a gruelling process. Congratulations, Mini Mick. You deserve it. And I reckon you'll do fine.
And blow it out of your ass.
No, you blow it out your ass. No, you blow it out your ass.
You blow it out of your ass. Come on.
I'm being attacked by Mini Mick. Sit down.
I think Mini Mick's been in my mini bar.
I think he has.
I think so.
Let's just all hold fire for a minute. That was fantastic, Tone. You've bought me so many presents. Are you done?
I think I am.
You're all silent. Well, that was one of the most amazing additions to a TV show I've ever seen. And I tell you what, before we go, the boys are lined up over there. And Janet, have you got another one in you? Let's hear from Spider-Mate.
See you soon.
smarter, mate. We'll be back after the break. Come on!
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 There's too much good music on this show, that's the problem. That was Spiderbait before the break too, and that's their album Grand Slam. Get on to that. That's the album of the year as far as I'm concerned. And have we got the tour dates there for the old Spiderbait? There they go. Read them and weep. Mostly weekends. Cram, what's the go? You got another job?
Yeah.
Pull up a pew,
yeah,
mate.
Thanks.
Jump on the end there.
Oh,
mate,
thanks,
you're welcome. It's Cram, everybody.
Thank you very much.
Yeah,
we're just going to be doing a lot
just
of work.
Just doing weekends. So. Well, get along. I just reckon you guys, well, they're pissing in your pocket. You're the best live act in the world at the moment, I reckon. And I've seen them all.
That's
every single
I can feel it filling
around
up as we speak.
There's been too much piss talk on this show. We're going to get back to you in a minute, Cram, because I want you to actually stick around for a very special segment that's coming up very shortly.
Yes, I'm trying to think. I can't.
You'll be right. You've got some thinking music. It'll be coming soon. But, Bobby, I noticed you're back on deck. What is your business here?
Well, Mickey, the cucumber sandwiches are a dead giveaway. I think perhaps you'd like to hand them around.
Sure.
Because it's time now for How Delightful.
And where is the hotel from here? Oh, I see. Oh, we should... Oh, excuse me. Could you take a photo of us, please?
Sure.
Thank you.
Oh, okay, if you just move back, I can get the whole harbour in.
Oh, great.
Okay, just back a bit more. Okay, back.
How delightful.
That was magnificent. And aren't the cucumber sandwiches good? Cram, have you ever had that in your rider?
I've never had a cucumber sandwich before.
But you're hooked.
And if not, yes, you will notice the crusts have been removed as well.
Correctly so.
This might remind you of anyone's played like tennis on Saturday afternoons, you know, ladies bring a plate.
Absolutely.
Well brought,
you know,
good plate.
Absolutely. That's the kind of thing that should be brought back. How delightful. Mm. It's wonderful. Hey, time for another segment now. And this one's called, quite appropriately, Who Would You Sleep With If You Were Gay? And I'm not sure, but is that Mini Mick on the left? I thought it was on that graphic. Let's start with me. It's my segment. I'm the host. Let's start with who I'd sleep with if I was gay. One choice as far as I'm concerned, Sipkowitz.
Sipkowitz?
Sipkowitz. That's his name, isn't it?
You mean Sipowitz?
Sipowitz. Hey, who's sleeping with him, me or you? That guy, I'm putting out an all points bulletin out on his white, chunky bot right now. I'm on deck, Bob. Who would you sleep with if you were gay?
I take it you mean gay as in homosexual, the colloquial slang term.
Pretty much.
Of course, it also can mean bright and cheerful.
Yeah. Just not on this occasion.
No. This occasion it's gay. I would go with Jeff Chance.
Jeff Chance, you say?
I feel there's so much Jeff could teach me, both in the kitchen and in the bedroom. But I would insist that Kerri-Anne was there as well.
There's an episode of What's Cooking I'd like to see. Tony Martin, who would you sleep with if you were gay?
I'd go with President Clinton, Mick.
President Clinton.
Just to find out what all the fuss is about. What's he packing?
What's it all about?
Or, secondly, Ricardo Montalban.
Oh, I thought. Hello.
He just knows how to treat you right, I feel.
You love that European well, type with the accent. Cram, who would you sleep with?
I've been thinking a lot, and I think I'd go with Homer Simpson, because I've always had this sort of fascination with cartoon characters and, you know, transferring that into sexuality, because it's very 90s to do so, is the way to go, I would say, wouldn't you?
You've been thinking about this a fair bit,
haven't you? I've got a thing about his butt crack. It just reminds me of something.
Homer Simpson's big yellow butt.
Have you ever noticed him from the back? He just looks fantastic.
I've noticed.
And he looks like this sort of, etc. Just next time you watch The Simpsons, look at him from the back. It's just the most
incredible. He's got a great ass, has he?
He looks like his ass goes all the way from the top of his head right down the bottom.
I went round to Cram's place one day, about 1:30, he goes, hey, you want to watch some stick film? Pulled out The Simpsons. Best off. Hey, Ashley, who would you sleep with if you were gay?
Me, I'm a bit of a hog when it comes to sex. I like to be dealt with from head to toe. I'd go for the Super Woodies. I'd go for Todd and Mark together.
You're going to be caught in a Woody sandwich.
Well, I don't know.
Watch out for splinters, my friend.
I just see myself laying there in the dark and somebody whispering in my ear, new balls, please. I just, you know, a forehand, a backhand, love all, 30, 40. Is that yogurt, Todd? Yes, I think it is, Mark. I'll have some. You know, I'll call me old-fashioned. If I can't have them, I'll go the war
cucumber
twins.
Cucumber sandwich.
This segment's only halfway in and I'm thinking of calling it off. Hey, Barry. In fact, I'm telling you what, I'm having a look over there. I wouldn't mind a piece of Barry's ass. Who would you sleep with if you were gay?
I've been watching Monkey Magic on Saturday mornings and I was going to go for the kid on the horseback, but he might be a bit too young.
So, good point. Let's not do that.
That's why, I think Pigsy.
Pigsy!
Yes. Oh.
Pigsy! All right, Kev?
Hey, you know I'm going big. I need big love. I'm going with Kim Beasley, you know? Lovely eyes, smiling, happy and big.
Have I left anyone out? Let's go over to the couch over there. Judith Lucy, who would you sleep with if you were gay?
Oh, you know, probably just about anybody. But it's a toss-up for me between Pat Benatar, because, of course, she knows love is a battlefield. And I also think that I'd have a bit of a mother complex, so I actually reckon I might go with Agnes Moorhead, who's in Dora from Bewitched, because my mother had very similar eye makeup. That's me, Coward.
Is Minnie Mick over there?
Come on!
Minnie Mick, who would you sleep with if you were gay?
Daryl Summers, the bling! Come on!
On your own, Minnie Mick!
The time is 10:55 and this show is officially off the rails!
Get stuffed, a lot of you!
Arch, what am I? Can I conclude? Who would you sleep with if you were gay? Is it time? Who would you sleep with if you're gay? Arch, take us out.
I don't know whether I should say it or not, Mick, but I reckon I'd go you.
You know, if this couch folded out into a bed, we'd be getting it on now, Arch. Is now the time to throw to the break?
I think so.
Get me out of here. That has been Who Would You Sleep With If You Were Gay? Cucumber sandwich.
Can people call in for the home version?
Yes. Kick it out. I'll be with you in a sec, chaps. I'm just going to take one last peek out the window, see if what's happening over there. If it's... Oh, dear. Oh, dear. I think he's watching the show. That's the distinct impression I get. Oh, look, he's lobbed on the couch. It's Lee Patch. We've saved you a cucumber sandwich, bro. Help yourself.
I never eat cylindrical fruits, Mick. Or vegetables.
Okay, what did he just say?
Cylindrical fruits.
Or vegetables.
I'll take them away.
Given the previous game.
It's an eyesore, I will remove it. Mm-hmm. Patchy, you're on the couch. I'm sensing something's up. What's it all about? What are we doing here? What is your purpose?
This segment?
Mm.
Well, Mick, if you could imagine the world of entertainment as just a big map, like you used to have in your school classroom, something like that.
Yep.
Well, I'm in a strange kind of land. Mm. To the north, there's Angela Bishop as far as the eye can see.
Yes.
To the south, there's Richard Wilkins just running wild.
Which was his original name.
Yeah.
What's left?
There is just me scampering, running.
Going nuts. Mm, going nuts. What's happening in the world of entertainment that we need to know? Now, and I say need to know.
I'm talking Sophia Loren.
Hello, what's happened?
Australian.
Because she's a timeless beauty.
She's one of my faves. She was involved in an incident at Harrods department store about 2 days ago, and viewers of Australian late night news bulletins might have seen some rather disturbing footage of Sophia cutting the ribbon to open a menswear sale at Harrods and then toppling off over the side of the stage. Rather disturbing footage.
What happened? What did she do?
She just fell over the side of the stage. She came a cropper.
What, like the clumsy chef from Sesame Street?
Exactly. But I'm here to say that an Australian was involved. An Australian caused what happened.
What happened?
On that night. Well, I think I should announce that the Australian was Peaches the Cockatoo.
I thought you were going to say it was Mike Whitney.
Slipping a 50.
No.
What happened? Hang on, I'm confused. You're telling me Sophia Loren is at Harrods, she's cutting a ribbon, she's gone over, and it's all because of a cockatoo.
Peaches the Cockatoo, he occupies a prized perch in the Harrods pet department.
Okay.
Sophia, to make it to the menswear department to open this sale, had to walk past Peaches on his prized perch.
That's what she was asking for.
Exactly. Now, a bit of background information about Peaches.
Mm.
He came up through the very kind of heartbreaking, tough Australian cabaret Avery circuit.
Right, okay.
He earned his feathers the hard way. Finally clawed his way to the Harrods pet department.
Yes.
And the last thing you want if you're Peaches the Cockatoo is an Italian movie star coming in, swanning around.
Mm.
So he sprang off the perch, flapped around the face, beaked her in the cheek. So she was bound to fall off stage about 15 minutes later. You can't blame her.
So what you're saying is she deserved it.
Mm.
She had it coming.
Mm.
But, and we have no footage of this?
We have no footage, unfortunately.
What about a dramatic reenactment?
Okay, can you be Peaches?
No, I can do the time Jessica Tandy was gored by a pig at the Oscars. I think the telecast ended before that went
through. That's right. Mm. That's right. That's archival footage.
But Peaches was escorted off the premises by two. It took two Harrods security guards to get him out of there. Mm. Would you believe that?
Wow.
But then he flew away and he was last seen heading towards Roberto Benigni's place in Italy.
Right.
He's going to go more Italians.
Wow, hey. So that's true. You know, I went to Harrods once and went into the toilets because I was busting.
Yeah.
And the guy wouldn't let me use their toilet until I showed him a voucher. Because you had to have shopped or bought something there. So I've run straight out the front and pissed on the pavement. Right out the front of Harrods. Mm-hmm. Right where there's about five limos lined up. They said, what are you doing? I said, I'm pissing you, nutter, because I don't have £2. They wanted £2 to go to the toilet, which in Australian terms at the time I think was about $5. That's where I said, nah, if we do a bargain, I'm in. But not at $5.
Mm. Was Sophia Loren seen pissing outside of Harrods?
Later on that day, yes.
Okay. Mm. Now, remember I said, what's happening in the world of entertainment? We need to know.
Mm-hmm.
I think that was the key phrase.
I don't think any entertainment news segment is worth its salt unless there's Pamela Anderson involved.
Hello, now we're talking turkey.
What's happened?
Did you see me prick up?
Yes, exactly.
I'm all ears now.
One, but two tidbits involving Pamela Anderson. First of all, to boost the sagging ratings of her very intellectual TV series VIP, which does not stand for very impressive posture, I can tell you.
No.
She's organised the casting of Loni Anderson, the 1980s breast implant pioneer, as her mother.
Crikey, no. Mm. Loni Anderson is playing Pamela Anderson's mother.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
In VIP.
This is a recipe for disaster.
Well, it's a recipe for something else because Pamela has decided she would like other Andersons casting key roles
during
the show. Mm. So I'm talking probably Melissa Sue Anderson from Little House on the Prairie.
Hello.
How do you remember that was who was in Little House on the Prairie?
You were more of a Laura Gilbert man, is that what you're saying?
Anyone who can remember all the cast names from Little House on the Prairie, that's got to be suspicious.
Loni Anderson, Pamela Anderson. Is this true? Did she actually have a breast reduction?
Pamela Anderson, very recently.
Well, we're broaching the big ones now. We're really on fire. Is that true?
She's moving back up the alphabet from D to C.
D to C. Can I buy a vowel? Mm. I saw, has she had it? Is it done? It has been done. Do I have bigger breasts than Pamela Anderson now?
You're a kind of a small bee.
Can we cut back to my photo in the foyer? I'm going to put that on my passport. Yep. All right, what else?
Well, just the second Pamela Anderson tidbit that I do have is she and Tommy Lee are marrying for a second time, which we all know. Mm. But what we don't know is...
They love each other.
And to prove
it... He beats her occasionally, but they love each other.
Exactly. And to prove their love for one another, they're offering up their wedding as a pay-per-view cable TV event in America.
You're not making that up.
No. And anyone who subscribes early, a month out from broadcast date, gets a VHS of their honeymoon. A kind of a semi-saucy R-rated number. Wow. Not quite of the calibre of the videotape that was circulating about 12 months ago.
That was free, wasn't it? I don't think that was a pay-per-view.
Is this serious?
Yeah, this is dead serious.
So they're making another trip to that well, are they?
Yes. Well, let's get their cut of the mustard this time.
Well, they didn't get a cut last time, did they? Because it was,
sadly.
This time, they're going in for big bicks.
Just lastly in entertainment news, Keanu Reeves has been circling the New Zealand production of, I think it's a live-action version of Lord of the Rings.
Hello. Is that who's really making that? That's the New Zealand director,
Peter Jackson, isn't it?
Frighteners and Braindead, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And what's he going to be doing? Part of the forest?
Well, my...
what will he be?
No, my speculation is that he might be driving around in a motorised mushroom, and if that mushroom goes beneath 10 miles an hour, the enchanted plot of the forest goes to smithereens.
It's just made up.
Yeah, I made that bit up.
Okay. Hey, now, do you have any film reviewing for us? Because that's one part of this whole entertainment package we were counting on. Is there anything going around at the moment we need to know about?
Mick, there's one major film release in Australia this week, and that's Sean Connery in Entrapment.
Mm-hmm.
Now, in this film, Sean plays a master thief, and he's kind of in his twilight years, but he still loves nothing better than a break and burgle.
Okay, cool.
Now, on his trail, on his tail, is the curvaceous Catherine Zeta-Jones. She's an insurance investigator.
Hello!
Now we're
talking to... Tell me they're not romantically paired.
Well, Mick, it could be heading down that path, but not before they get up to some crazy action hijinks first. Let's have a look at this.
Where's the badge?
I broke it.
What?
I'm sorry.
Wow. What's it all about? What does it mean?
Well, if you can't figure out what that scene means, wait till you see this next bit of footage I've got for you. It's a push for a description. I would say you'd have to drive a very long way to find a kinkier bit of cheesecake jazz ballet. Let's have a look at this.
Jazz ballet?
Here it comes.
Okay. Up a little more. Now bend the knee.
He's taking Tai Chi.
Again, what's it all about?
A completely meaningless scene. And this film, it's not completely flash, I must say. It's a pretty typical kind of crime caper film. Mm. But one thing you might have picked up from seeing those two scenes, there's a slight age difference between Sean Connery and Catherine Zeta-Jones.
Bingo.
I would say all of 40 years.
At least.
Sean is now 69 years of age. Catherine is 29 years of age.
Mm-hmm.
Mm.
There was one film a few years ago where Sean Connery played Dustin Hoffman's dad. And, it's family business.
Family business.
A bank robbery. Okay. There's 5 years difference between them.
It's true. Look it up.
There you go.
It's all happening.
But, I was kind of so inspired and just wanted to deconstruct the mystique of, Sean Connery's infinite age appeal, given that he's 69 years of age.
Sure.
I decided to hit the streets of Melbourne just to kind of find out what the hell is going on with Sean Connery and young women.
You did this week?
Vox Poppy, here we go.
Jack Nicholson, Harrison Ford, Robert Redford, and this week in Entrapment, Sean Connery. Do those names make you horny, baby? I don't think so. But for some strange reason, Hollywood studio execs want us to believe that there's a generation of young women out there absolutely aching to knock knees with these knock-kneed old codgers. So today we want the answer to one question only. Is Sean Connery pretty fly for an old guy?
I think he's very sexy. I probably shouldn't. He's much older than me, but yeah, like, a lot of my friends, I think he's sexy, like, got that older kind of man thing.
Now, Sean's 69 years of age. How old are you?
19.
I always sort of liked him, but he's definitely sexy.
So you'll be going to see Entrapment?
Definitely.
And your age?
I'm 17.
Dooley dooley, so a 52-year age difference would not bother you one iota?
No, not at all.
We were wondering, Sean Connery, is he a shagable proposition in this day and age?
Oh, absolutely. He's divine. He's gorgeous.
Sean Connery, is he a shagable proposition in this day and age?
Definitely. Most definitely.
What does it for you? What is it with the Sean Connery and the young
Connery,
woman?
Sean Connery, babe, an old man that's just very sexy. Mm-hmm. Very sexy body from, hell, shagable.
Well, just so happens we're prepared an older man for a road test. Would you be prepared to just kind of sit down and just kind of let us know how the whole old thing sits with you?
Okay.
Uh-huh. Just give us a road test.
Yeah, he's pretty sexy.
Was there something?
Yeah, I mean, he's got a good body and everything.
How can you tell from that?
I can't really, it's like kissing my dad. Sorry. Sorry. Sorry, you probably can't use that. Sorry.
Well,
again, that proves absolutely nothing.
I don't think you've answered any questions tonight. I reckon you've just turned up and messed with our heads, Patchy.
No, I think it's important to start every segment kneeling on a manhole cover, I find. I'm going to be doing that for my segments.
Hey, Patchy, thanks for dropping by. I look forward to checking in with you next week. We're going to be back after this with Pendo and Sport.
So old man Griggs has turned up about 3:30 Wednesday. Says he wants all the roofs tiled by Saturday.
Oh, I've got the other job to do.
Here goes the indoor cricket.
Well, you try chatting him, sort of talk to him until I'm blue in the face. Well, drink up, boys. We're in about 30 seconds.
I give up. What is going on? We're going to have to look at the videotape of this show back like a black box recording. I have no idea what's going on.
Crazy.
It is. Hey, welcome, Pendo. Hey, bro. Kevin Wood. Patchy and Cram are hanging around. We heard we're talking sport. They're keen to fire up. What's going on? You, my friend, I haven't seen you in daylight hours for about 2 months because there's been World Cup, there's been Wimbledon. You come in, you're knackered, you leave, you watch sport. It's all you do. What have you got?
Oh, it's been mad, Mick. You haven't been to bed for, I think 4 a.m. is about the earliest, the last 6 weeks. Yeah. Wimbledon's been on. Magnificent Wimbledon. I think Australians did well. Dockick. Watch her, Patchy.
Now, what's the deal? Is she now, they're saying she's worth $5 million a year. She's got endorsements.
Oh, it'll keep rocketing up. Yeah. I think you'll notice with her too, she's got a real, real passion about her and a real fighter.
Yeah.
One set down, she'll give it her best. She gives them a stare at the other end. Yeah. Bang, and it's on.
Tell me if I'm wrong, but I have not watched tennis, especially men's tennis, since like the Borg, the McEnroe eras. Yeah. It's just Sampras, serve.
There's a chance every time Sampras and Agassi play, there's a chance, but Sampras has this mental edge over Agassi. Agassi can beat anyone else in the world, but when it comes to Sampras, it's like, I've got you. We grew up together. Sure. Have you noticed that? Like, he totally is.
And you reckon it gets to a point where if you haven't beaten him after so many, you never get there?
It's like the old school friend that always used to beat you at golf or footy and stuff, and you might be the best golf as soon as I see old Dicko again, and he turns up.
You know, the other thing, especially with tennis, I reckon, and this, I mean, my personal experience, and I played Davis Cup for Australia.
Was that you?
Big fat bastard running around, huffing and wheezing. But, like, tennis, I reckon, is one of those games more than any other where you play to the other person's ability. Like, if you were playing with someone who was, like, drunk, You'd play that badly. If you're playing against, you know, Dockett, you'd play well. Did you find that?
Yeah, I mean, they seem to get themselves up at different moments during the event. But I thought Wayne Arthurs, Patchy, you made a comment about Wayne Arthurs, an Australian bloke, out of nowhere.
I think Wayne Arthurs has the ability to be the next Wally Masseur.
Oh. That's a very good point. Wayne Arthurs is one type of Australian player, and it's like, oh, I'm just happy to be here. Oh, gee, that's really great. Oh, gee, I can't believe I'm actually one. And then there's your Pat Cash, like, oh, you pricks, yeah, piss off, you know? And yet you're two types of Australian players.
That's
I would
right.
put Dockett in the more Pat Cash thing. Huh? Yeah. It's like really grunting to win. Well, not, you know, unhappy about anything unless. You know. And I'd like to bring up another point. There's nothing to do with this.
Come on.
Archie, do you know, like, your stage manager Archie looks exactly like...
Yeah, the guy wants
like,
to sleep with
he
me.
He looks exactly like Pete Postlethwaite in Jurassic Park, The Lost World. Have you ever seen that? You do, man. You look like spitting image of Pete.
Yeah, you're
it's
doing
true, me. The hunter, you know. It's like, anyway.
Thanks for bringing it up.
Yeah, sorry, forget
but it. But you know what? I'm not coming because I can't believe Wally Masseur's name didn't come up in Who Would You Sleep With If You Were Gay. That was a lost opportunity.
It's a good
comment. The Tour de France, Mick.
Oh, the Tour de France.
Started.
Hey, what's going on? There's a bit of argy-bargy there today. Someone nearly got done over. Tell me this. It's a big Barney for one yellow top. Bring your own, I say.
Oh, yeah. But the other thing amazed me with them, they can race all day, right? And, you know, they've been cycling for 6 or 7 hours. The sprint comes on. We're still about 40 of a minute, right up till the end.
Yeah.
I've heard it's become more of the Tour de Pharmacy.
The cycling world is in a debacle at the moment, isn't it?
Yeah, see, there's more drugs in cycling than rock and roll these days, buddy. Get on the bike.
Well, yeah, that's true, but the people in rock and roll can take more drugs for a longer period legally.
And I'll point out, Hesse, Barry and Kev rode to the shootouts today on one of those goodies tandem bikes with the LA jerseys.
Well, let's cut that off.
We'll cut that off. Look, have there been any good stacks? I love the stacks in the tour. I love the cycling stacks. They're the best in the world. One goes down, they're all gone.
And because they're attached to their bikes, you know, it's going to be really bad.
God love the gravel
race. We'll catch up on some Tour de France next week. At the end of the second week, Grady's coming fourth as of this afternoon.
Yeah, but he always runs out of puff. He starts good. He never finishes. I know what I'm talking about.
Gee, with the cricket, the World Cup.
Hey, we're on too late. Has that been the biggest sporting news in the last year, the last 3 years in this country? That was a sensational effort.
Exactly. Warning.
Yeah.
No questions asked.
He came good, didn't he?
I bagged him out.
Yeah, you would have. Everyone did.
Straight up, literally the ball before he got Gibbs, I was like, oh, he's over, he's gone, he's gone. And then he bowls him. And
mate, I think there was a few people, myself included, going, all right, yeah. All right, Warney. You're the best. you've got to pay that.
Yeah, that's of course it. You do.
A guy has two World Cups under the belt. He's got a great... Was he not the first one? I don't know much about sport.
No, you're pretty...
I think you made you look kind of foolish.
No. Mick was actually a very good bat, top number four, but we watched a lot of cricket together.
We have indeed.
During the World Cup.
Was that the most exciting time we had? That really was sensational.
We've gone to comedy camp, and comedy camp, as the name suggests, and I've got all the comedians watching cricket. I thought it was bloody great.
But do you know what I mean? What I can't understand is if Pakistan had a one or India had a one or Sri Lanka, like it's a national holiday for 6 months. Yep. You know, do you reckon it affected the Australian psyche here? Do you reckon it really, really took hold?
No, I don't know. But one thing that I think they realised when they got back was that a lot of cricket followers that don't normally follow the cricket had picked up on it. Like Steve Luby, our producer, I didn't pick him for a cricket bloke at all. Mm. Monday morning after the World Cup, he comes in, he's been on something for days.
Oh, I sacked him twice that morning. Sent him home.
Greg Sitch, he was walking around like this. He couldn't believe it.
He's done. He's gone.
Pindo, what about the absolute largeness of Steve Waugh's comment to Herschel Gibbs in the semi-final? Mate, you've just dropped the World Cup. Is that one of the largest sporting comments of all time?
Absolutely.
I wish I get some recordings of Steve Waugh abusing other players. He's always so nice, you know.
Exactly.
And he's renowned as being the most abusive
But how
player.
Hard does he play it? He's got that mental toughness, and he can say whatever he wants out there as far as I'm concerned.
He's the best. He is now in the same class as Lara and Tendulkar. Not as a natural, but as a match winner for their country and the guy who comes
mentally
up on the big occasion.
Mentally tough.
He's a sensation. Hats off to all involved. And, in fact, hats off to you, Pendo, because we actually sent Pendo down... When the World Cup team headed back to Australia, there was a ticker tape parade down in Melbourne.
Great.
We sent Pendo along. It was his first assignment for this show, and we kind of tenderly sent him off and said, good luck, don't be shy. The guys bowled in, asked the first seven questions that were broadcast all around on the news services all around Australia, and you're in there, he was on the team bus. They're trying to pull out, he's on the bus. They have to stop and turf him.
Well, I reckon that's fair enough. I walked into that room, there's cameras, lights, there's a lot of ties and suits. And I've just gone casually and stood off to the side when it all started, and I thought, well, I better get a couple of questions in.
Get them in early, mate.
In case I get no one-on-ones afterwards. So a little bit of go for it. It's like giving the new ball. Now, you've handed me the new ball and said, go for it.
So you've done it. You've come back with a package. Do you want to show it?
Go on there. We'll have a look. It was a great day. We got to the Hilton, had a look at the press conference and followed the ticker tape parade. It was a tremendous day. I think Sydney was fantastic as well. They got behind it as well, and the whole country did. So let's go and have a look at the footage and have a look at how my big day went, Mick.
Beautiful.
The game had gone each way. Did you feel as though your luck had to change? And what were you yelling out to him?
Throw it with one word in front of it.
I felt as though it was really happening myself. That drift back in, starting to go wide of the crease and all that sort of stuff again. We're happy the way it was coming out, got the drift back and then.
Good on you, mate. Thanks.
I thought you maybe could have come over the wicket to Clewster and given him a couple just up there. Were you thinking of that? I know the short grounds with the wax through like that. Did you think about giving him one of those? No one gave him one all tournament.
Yeah,
really.
probably should have, but the semi-final, the wicket there was really slow.
Yeah.
So it would have just sat up and said, hit me.
Bang.
No, actually, I didn't bowl that well. It was. I'm glad the other guys bowled so well.
I took that last catch and I was just headed for the change.
You're off, weren't you?
Yeah, if anyone got in my way, I was going to bowl them over. So.
did you lose a little weight and were you know, quite drained mentally and physically after the West Indies?
It definitely was a tough tour. With Tugger as captain for the first tour, I think he was bowling me in the ground, bowling me 15 over spells at a time. I thought, dodgy bastard. But
get back in everyday life at home and go into the dogs every Monday and Thursday night and a few Saturday afternoons at the footy, no doubt.
I mean, obviously, the 39 must have been great to get in the West Indies. It shut a few of the boys in the team up, did it? Or?
Yeah, I was only against Ambrose and Walsh, so yeah, no big deal.
Hello, guys, how are you? You well? I'm actually sober at the moment, so I've done pretty well.
Lovely shot off the back foot to get the winning run. You're looking comfortable that night.
Very happy with that. Yeah. Nothing, I'll never forget that.
So a big moment, Jack?
Huge, mate. Unbelievable.
Yeah. Yeah. Makes you realise how much everyone gets behind the cricket.
Oh, exactly. When you're over there in the heat of the battle, you don't realise, but coming home to this is magnificent.
We heard that people got behind us over there, but you've got no idea.
And Mick and I, we love the nice oral, lads. Any more to come?
You don't need any. You're all right.
Sensational work, Brando. That's the first assignment we sent him on. First assignment we sent him
and
on, and you're in their boots and all.
Like heaven. I'll just explain, though. When it went, I thought it was all a bit strange. I thought that, you know, that the questions might have been, you know, your turn. And I got there and I thought, well, it's obviously just go for it sort of thing.
So pretty much.
Fired off the first few. Started to get a bit excited. You know, same Warren up there. I'm thinking, God, I'd love to ask him about 25 things. So I got a little bit excited and started to say, you know, the rhythm was going well, the flight, whatever. And I think he thought, what's this bloke on, Croc? He's off to the side asking strange questions. And Steve Waugh actually whispered in him and he'd pick it up on the footage again. But he goes, you want to be coached, do you, mate? And I thought, oh, I will. I'll take that job any day.
One day you will be coached, Pendo. Hey, before we drop sport, and I know it's been a load of fun, here's a great story that's been floating around all week. And this is,
yep.
Cram, you'd be across this, the marching band's furore.
Oh, you didn't get the gig?
No, I could have done it all.
The Olympics. And this is a furore. There was, in case you don't know, it's in here somewhere. There was a story regarding the American bands which were due, the marching bands which were going to play at the opening ceremony of the Olympics. Michael Knight, I think Talkback Radio may have got their hands on it because it was, why don't we have Australians? Why don't we have an Australian marching band? So apparently now the American marching bands have been asked completely. They may get a gig on the steps of the Opera House. It's Australian marching bands that are going to come to the fore. In fact, I just hope out they don't fight their overseas athletes coming to the games, because Australia will go, oh, they're taking jobs off our athletes. All go home. That's Australia only. But anyway, look, there's a huge furor and it still hasn't been settled. American marching band, Australian marching band, who knows what's going to happen.
Why do they need marching bands?
Exactly.
It's about the athletes.
Terence Trent D'Arby in excess.
Terence Trent D'Arby.
Was that a match made in heaven? That worked for you, Graham. Well, we've got something of similar ilk lined up right now, and this is the Mick Molloy Show tribute.
Yeah, it's great.
And we're going to donate this to the opening ceremony of the Olympics. Can we cut to the car park? There it is. There's your opening ceremony.
Oh, no. Oh,
see you again. is spectacle. That is majesty. The one bloke, three drums, going round, doing all that. That's it. Hey, that's enough sport. Thanks, Pendo. Do appreciate it. Thanks for dropping by. Before we go to the break, can we do this? I really want to do this. I reckon Australia needs to see this. A few weeks ago, this not long ago, I was sent a tape from Adelaide, pretty much which sat me on my ass, and it was a few blokes who were running around town calling themselves Loose Booty, and they're not shy. In fact, they're quite happy to get out and get amongst it. I'm going to throw to it now. This is going to take us out of the break, Australia. Strap yourself in for Loose Booty.
All about.
Oh, he's getting in. Fuck it up.
Yeah, right. You look like a drunkard.
Oh, baby.
I'm not explaining what's going on here.
We just want to take a ride, bro. Take a ride. We just want to go ride, drive.
We too.
Thanks,
I really don't need this.
Stuff.
All right, it's off. Okay, it's off.
It's off.
Let me have a look. It's all right.
No. Film you eating it.
You want to film me eating this?
Yeah, sure, man. No. Bigger bite. Bigger bite. Yeah, that's right. A bigger bite.
What's the camera, man?
Turn that off too, thank you.
Lady.
Oi.
Take it off, will you? Thanks.
Hello, I'd like a quarter pounder with cheese and two large fries and maybe a large Coke. Thank you, young man. It's been a wonderful experience.
Get back in the car, you bitch. Get back in.
Boys, you've been there for me all night, and I really appreciate it. Absolutely.
I'm here to serve, sire, and serve you only.
And you've discharged your duty.
Oh,
well done, Essie. Well done, boys. That's the best. Hey, we're out of time. In fact, we're late. Look out, we're in trouble. We're 5 minutes late already. Let's power through this. I've just been handed a list of complaints that's been handed to the bloke that's been out at Channel 9, mate. We've got some reading to do. It's like the A to K of the telephone book, I swear to God. Oh, dear. That's going to amuse us for hours after the show. And if you don't like it, as Mini Mick says, blow it out your ass. Go somewhere else. We're happy. We're not moving. We're in for the long haul.
We're employed.
Right, the Robin Pigeon. Write your letters.
Why, oh, why has Mick Molloy used such profane language?
Plenty where that came from. Hey, I'll tell you what. Can I mention, this is the segment where we'll normally do late mail. And being our first show, we don't have much, only the complaints. But if we have a look over there, can we cross to, we've got a website and a website address. And the website, should you want to email us, or
isn't it blowitoutyourass.com?
blowitoutyourass.com. That's it. There. Do we have the address?
There
it is. There. www.themickmolloyshow.blah.blah.blah.
Yes.
And you can contact us there. You know, the only bit of good luck the only well wishing we've had is actually by a good friend of ours and a former cohort, Rob Sitch from the panel.
All right.
From Working Dog, and he sent us in a bit of a message, and let's refer to it right now.
Greetings, Mick. I am speaking to you from another network. If you are playing this message, it can mean only one thing. The John Farnham special has gone to air. But I must take this rare moment of peace and cross-promotion to give you a warning. You are now our enemy, Mick Molloy. You are now our enemy, Mick Molloy. As I speak, Channel 10 are marshalling their forces against you. Movies, some as recent as 1983. Footloose, Dirty Dancing, Staying Alive, Ghost, St. Elmo's Fire. Are going to be in your time slot. Well may you tremble in fear, good chum, for it is now war. And if you come between us and the Logie for crappy late night television, we will crush you.
Swing your camera over. We've got a couple of the Working Dog boys in there tonight. There's Tommy and there's Glenn Robbins from the
camera. Gee whiz, you've forgotten already, buddy. Thanks very much. Hey, I could have done something funny on the tape. I could have done Uncle Arthur or something.
We got another 19 episodes.
No worries. I'll get it out for you, buddy. No problem at all.
Now, thanks for coming along tonight. And as a special treat, I was watching on Wednesday night and you played the Navy footage.
Yes.
And I thought, what a great thing. Well, here's a treat just for you boys.
Yeah.
We've got the same thing but unpixelated.
No. Really?
Would you like a little look-see?
I'd love to see.
Come on, fire it up. Here we go. Hello. Oh. There's some butt action right there. And say hello, like that. That's enough. Stop. Let's get out of there. We probably didn't need to see that. Here's the deal. This is what's got me flummoxed, though, boys. Tell me what you think. Because I've been studying this, and when you might be familiar with this yourself, but like when water runs down a drain in the southern hemisphere, it runs anti-clockwise. In the northern hemisphere, it runs clockwise. As the sump oil was going down his bot, as he crossed the equator, would it have S-bend? On that note,
the Navy is stealing loose booties material.
Would it? unbelievable. That's exactly how our press launch went.
Really?
That was it. That was the entertainment. Are we all done? Are we all silent? Have we had enough fun for one night? I think we have. Thank you, everyone. I don't know quite how to do it, who to thank or whatever, but Spider Bait and everyone who was on tonight and everyone who helped and everyone who just sat there and enjoyed it with us, thank you very much. Hesse, have you got something special? Have you and the largest got something to take us out with tonight that might just, well, lighten the mood a tad?
Well, it is. Next week, I've got my good friend here, Kudja Edwards, going to sing a song for us tonight.
Hey, Kudja! Hey, bro. See you, bro.
Now, Next Saturday in Melbourne at the Concert Hall, there's a big kick-ass concert. It's the Songlines Music Festival, featuring Kudja, Blackfire, many of the bands that have been... Kelly. Paul Kelly's going to be down there.
David Bridie.
A lot of people. There's still tickets available. We've been involved in this beautiful program all the year. It's a lot of young Aboriginal people singing on stage in their bands for the first time over this year. So it's a big thing to come and see and do. It's a good thing to do. Better
Absolutely.
Than watching telly all night.
Gotcha, mate.
Magnificent mentors too in Kevin, Barry and Paul.
Absolutely, bro. You hooked up with a good outfit there, could you?
Thanks, buddy.
Can't go wrong, mate.
The largest.
Well, we'll take it out. We've got a song of Kudja's called Stay With Me.
I wrote it for my father, actually. So he's now passed away, so I'll...
All right.
It's called Stay With Me.
Here we go, ladies and gentlemen. I believe I start this one, Michael.
Okay.
I picture your face in the back of my mind. Memories of those moments in time I shall hold so very dear. For those precious memories I will always shed a tear. I turn to you in despair to ask for your forgiveness, to see if you still care, to hold you in my arms again, just to see you smile. We'll take away the pain, make it all worthwhile. Stay with me just for the moment, yeah. Stay with me just for a little while. Tell me in the time.